Hello all. I want to thank first LEHAC for inviting me here to speak today and follow the arrangements. I really appreciate it. So my name is Nikolaos Tsapakis and I work as a security engineer. I have been working the last 10 years professionally for a couple of companies like Symantec and Citrix. And before that, I have been working as a software engineer mostly. So today we are going to talk about a forensics story, actually, which dates back to 2019, pre-COVID. So the story is that once upon a time, I had a small hard disk and I didn't really need it. So before throwing it into junk, I decided that I want to format it as everyone can think of, just erasing the data and then throw it into junk. But when I started the format process, I remembered that I have not keep a backup of an important file. So I actually interrupted the process, but the format has already been performed at some percentage, and many of the structures on the disk were already been gone. So the file was about a poem, a very important file for me, I guess. And this story is like trying to find a way and recovering that file from this disk. So this hard disk had a FreeBSD image on it with a ZFS file system, like something minimal, just a default installation. And when the disk has been set up, the compression has been enabled. So what it actually does is when a file is being written on the disk, before it's been written, it's been compressed on the fly, and then it's been put on the disk. So it saves lots of space, depending on the file type, of course. So the compression was LZ4. It's like a fast compressor, which ZFS system uses. And the truth is that I tried many tools on the disk in order to be able to see what files I am able to recover. Of course, there were tools that I found available out there, and I tried them as a shareware. But nevertheless, I was not able to recover the file. Maybe some other files were able to be fetched and to recover, but this particular file, I couldn't find it anywhere. So I started thinking, maybe, what if we could just find a way to read the disk directly and perhaps scan it and see what data we can get out of it, and perhaps some were hidden in this data. Maybe this file is. So that's what this story is about. The first step would be to get rid of the actual hardware disk, right, and create an image of the disk as a big file in order to be able to play with it, to scan it, to do whatever we want. So we use like a classic tool, DDRescue, and we are able to dump the block file, which is our disk, ADA0, to a file system like file, the dot backup here, as we see, which is almost 25 gigabytes of size, right? We don't expect something huge here because this was just a default installation that was used for personal purposes, nothing more. And now that we have this backup, we can also transfer it between different systems. We can share it. We can give it to other people, maybe to give it a try, etc., etc. So we can actually start working with that image. So before starting immediately to work on this case, it's good to make some assumptions because it's possible to save us lots of time during the analysis. So the first thing that I can recall is that this is an RTF type of file, like a simple document file. I remember also that this file does not have other poems or literature, stories, etc. in this. It's just a single poem of 2 pages. So most probably it could be below 24 kilobytes of size. So a small file. Of course, the ZFL file systems, and according to other similar file systems, it can allocate multiple blocks of space in order to save potentially a bigger file. But it is quite possible also, if the size of the file is very small, to just allocate a single data block and save all the file in a continuous way on this single data block. Which, of course, if this is the case, it will make our job much easier because we don't have to search in the disk in various places, different sectors, etc., and try to find various parts of the file, find a way to compile them all together, etc. I also noticed that the smallest data block in the ZFS file system was close to 65 kilobytes, which is a good also overlapping with the assumption that the file is less than 64 kilobytes of size. So eventually, if we are lucky, maybe one data block should be enough. But of course, at this point, when we have the image of the disk, we don't even know if the file is there, right? So before starting doing anything, we should be able to verify that we still have this file somewhere on the disk, or at least to have some candidates. So the idea would be, since we remember that this is an RTF file, and this can be extended to other types of files, we can create a sample RTF file, for example, maybe compress it using the same algorithm that we know, using LZ4, check some bytes on the file, and then perhaps create a signature, and we can use this signature to scan the image file in order to file RTF files, right? And since we are able to verify that one of these files perhaps is our file, that's something that will make us very happy, actually. So that's what we're going to do. This is what we're going to follow. So in order to create a signature, we want to find a sequence of bytes that are of interest for us and most possible are going to work. So we get a test file. We just create a sample without having anything on it, a test RTF, as you can see. And we can use the LZ4 tool, which is on a classic Linux system, to compress our file. And then we can check in the first bytes, actually, of the file. And what we can see is before and after the compression, there are 7 bytes in the beginning of the file, which are the same before and after the compression. So perhaps this sequence of bytes is a good candidate to create a signature, right? So we select these 7 bytes in order to make our signature. So for creating a signature and scan the image, we use a classic tool, Yara, which is a tool used by also security researchers to create signatures and detect a malicious file or non-malicious file, etc. It can combine many logics inside a rule file. So our rule file is like very simple. It just checks for these 7 bytes that we highlighted earlier. And if this signature has been found, then pop up a message saying that something we detected here, a potential candidate. So we run this rule against the file that we generated using the DDRescue tool. So we run Yara using as input detect rtf.yara, which has our signature, against ada0.backup disk image. And in the results, we can actually see at least 6 notifications, let's say. You can see actually the row offset of the ADA0 backup file where these sequences were found. So we have potential six candidates, six files, and if we're lucky, one of those six files could be the file that interests us. If there is zero false positive in here, right? Because perhaps there is a text file or something that could contain these 7 bytes, highly unlikely, but you never know. So we can jump straight to the location in the image file, to the offset where this signature was triggered. You can see actually here the signature highlighted in the yellow color. By checking this structure, let's say, these bytes, we notice that before this signature, there is a double word, like 4 bytes, highlighted in blue, which seems to be a number, like 00001A85. Then is the signature, which is, of course, part of the data, because initially we generated it from the RTF file, so it's part of the data of the file. And following this, there are more data, which ends in some trailing zeros, let's say. So it seems to be a structure here. Overall, in many files and in many formats out there, it's very common to have like a structure like header data, so some data which describe the next data, etc., etc. This could be also the case. The thing is that between the red, between the yellow color and between the green color, so the start of the data and the end of the file, that we assume it's the end of the file, the number of bytes is the number highlighted by the blue color. So we could assume that this blue color is perhaps some sort of size of the data that follow, right? If we look in the specification of the LZ4 of the compression, we can see something similar. But we also see, except from the data and the size, so the blue and the orange, there should be something in the beginning, before the blue. But here we don't see anything. We just see zeros, right? So we don't see any kind of header, actually, here. So the idea would be, what if we make an assumption that this could be an LZ4 buffer, all of it, with a missing header, and maybe we can try to reconstruct a minimal header from the specification. That could be an idea that we could try, right? So if we go to the specification, to the LZ4 specification, we will actually see that the LZ4 header can have 7 bytes. So in the specification, the description of the bytes are like following. The first 4 bytes is a magic number, so it's a static number identifying that this is something related to LZ4, an LZ4 buffer. It's always the same. There is 1 byte following, which have various properties, like the version of the compression, some checksums existence, etc., etc. There is 1 more byte, the BD, which contains the maximum block size. When we say block, similar to the 64 kilobytes comments that we mentioned earlier. And 1 last byte, which is a sort of checksum on the header itself, calculated using a hashing algorithm on the previous 2 bytes, FLG and BD. So by extending this idea, maybe we can create this minimal header by making some assumptions as most simplistic as we can in the beginning. So we start with simple, and if it doesn't work, we go with more complicated stuff. So like going through the header values 1 by 1, the first double word, the 4 bytes, the magic number, it's 04224D18. It's static, we don't have to say anything about it. The next, the flag byte, we set, according to the specification, the following values. We set the version to 1, it's something also kind of static. We assume that each block could depend on the previous one for decoding, because when the algorithm of the compression is being applied, the way it compresses it may take into account the sequence of the blocks, the sequence of the bytes inside the file. So we say yes. Let's say that the blocks are depending on each other. Then we say that we don't really need a checksum in data blocks, because if we say that we need, then the header will be bigger. So we just skip it. We also say that we don't have any uncompressed size within the header, so we continue with 7 bytes. No content checksum, nothing. Reserve bit set to 0 by default, and no dict ID. So this is something that has to do with a compression algorithm again, like a dictionary for making it perhaps faster in some cases. So we just also skip it. The next byte, as we said, is about the maximum size of the block. So taking into consideration that this is a small file and everything could be in a single block file, we just set it to 64 kilobytes, which is a nice assumption and could be possibly correct for our case. And the last byte, we calculated using a hashing algorithm based on the two previous files with this small Python script. We get this value, and we append it as a last byte in the header. So now, we actually go back to the slide where we used to have this red header filled with zeros, and now we have a header filled with actual values based on the analysis and the simplistic approach that we took. So we have the magic again, we have the flag, we have the BD, we have the checksum, and then we have the compressed data size, which already exists on the disk, we have the compressed data, which already exists on the disk, and the yellow here highlights the signature, and we have the trailer, which is just some nulls highlighting the end of the data. So this is actually a buffer which contains the compressed data of the file, potentially, and should be enough to apply on top of this buffer the LZ4 decompression and get the original file. So if we are lucky enough, we could get something back. So what we did, what I did at this point, is I created a Python script to automate all this for me. So the Python script does all of this with some code. So it first checks the hard disk image for the existence of the signature. Whenever it finds this signature, it prepends a header by creating the header, and then try to decompress it using LZ4, the buffer. If it's successful, it dumps the output to a file. If it's not successful, it just pops up a message saying, I didn't make it, and just continue, go on. So by using actually this small tool, I was able to recover the file that I wanted, and I was able also to recover some other files. Not all of them I was able to open them, because this script does not take into account if the file is big enough and it's spread between different data blocks, right? It just takes the place where it founds and reads the length and extracts the content. If we would like to create something more complicated, we need to do much more work on this. So we would probably need to find out where all these pieces of a file could be. We would probably need to connect these pieces together. And this is something that would require significant additional work. But for our case, for this small file, everything worked, went perfect, and we were able actually to extract the content. So for this kind of investigation, I have written a small paper, which is around 6 to 7 pages. Everything is uploaded in this GitHub repository. So in this GitHub repository, you will find the original paper. You will find some additional code using this tool, creating this tool for Python 3. And inside the article, there is also some code, the same script written for Python 2. But since there are some years between now and the day when the article was written, I just also written it for Python 3. There is also a minimal image in there, so you can apply the script on the image. And actually, you can fetch the file that I recovered by myself, the same file, which also has this lovely poem, if you want to read it. So that's it, I think, more or less. Again, I will highlight all the process, what we did from the beginning, just as an epilogue. So the idea was to be able to fetch a file from a disk that it has compression on and was not able to find exactly the contents of the file as were original. For this reason, we created a signature that we assume it is going to match this file. Then we decoded the structure that is related to LG4 buffers. We created a minimal header, and we give it a try and iterate through all the possible files that we can find on the disk. If we were not able to find the file, there is still room for improvement. We can play with a header, for example, and we can switch on some flags, turn them on, etc., etc., and see what else we are able to get. But we are super lucky, I guess, at this point. So yeah, that's it. If you have any questions, I'd be glad to answer them. And thanks a lot for your attention.
Questions?
Thank you very much.
Do you have questions? Est-ce que quelqu'un a une question? Dans ce cas-là, manifestez-vous. Bah reste là, du coup. Là-bas. Quelqu'un peut aller. Ça arrive.
Thanks for the conference. I was wondering if you. Did you read the ZFS source code to figure out how the parameters for LD4 were set up, or did you just guess them?
Yeah, so if I understand correctly, you mentioned if I checked a little bit on the structure of the ZFS file system itself to be able to... not actually, no, it's the answer. I didn't went through this because at that point I was able to restore the file, so my initial thinking was to go through the actual ZFS and see perhaps if the header is somewhere else. You know, this information is possible to be somewhere else. And perhaps there is also information on the structures, for sure, I guess, it should be, linking parts of the files bigger than 65 kilobytes. So definitely this is something that should be done for bigger files, and there is a possibility for doing so, yeah. Yeah, thanks.
Anyone else?
Merci.
Quelqu'un d'autre pour une question? Très bien.
Thank you very much.
Merci, Nicolaos.
Thanks a lot. Thank you.